2015 Community Planning and Development Commission. So we have two public hearings tonight, both for zoning amendments for the November town meeting. So Nick, why don't we have you start with the public hearing, and then we'll jump in.
Yeah, public hearing, legal notice for proposed zoning bylaw amendments. First one to Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 48, Section 5, adoption or change of zoning ordinances or bylaw. Notice is hereby given that the Reading Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, June 29, 2015, at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room of the Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to discuss the proposed zoning amendments to Section 1.0 purpose, complete text relative to the proposed amendment, and more information are available for public inspection between 7:30 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. Monday through Thursday and until 7 p.m. on Tuesdays in the Community Services Department at the Reading Town Hall.
Thank you. All right, so this is how we're going to proceed with both this agenda topic and the next one. So first, we're going to get a short presentation from Jesse on what's been edited and what we're talking about. We'll allow any members of the CPDC to make any comments that they wish, and then we can open it up for public comment. All right, so Jesse, I'll turn it over to you.
So it is pretty basic for Section 1. We made some changes based on the suggestions of special town meeting in 2014, as well as some comments from the Zoning Advisory Committee and input from the CPDC. Ultimately, we wanted to make it simple and concise, and we essentially just added one paragraph and deleted one statement to Section 1. It's very simple, and this is essentially the nature of the changes. Bold is new, cross out is being deleted. And we're taking away the lettering to ease in administration.
So if you recall from town meeting, the Zoning Advisory Committee actually redid a lot of the bullets, and I think the feedback that was received was that's not necessarily in alignment with the goals, the vision of this town. There was some good work and some good suggestions that were made on the town floor or town meeting floor about taking a look at the town of Lexington and their simple purpose statement. So that's what we've done here. The first, what's in bold, is I think pulled directly from Lexington. And then the bullets that sit underneath it are verbatim what is in our existing zoning bylaw.
Which is reflective of the actual act itself.
Right, that's right. That mapping was done of the bullets to our master plan.
Well, to be fair, I think that, I mean, the reason that the Zoning Advisory Committee suggested the reducing the purpose is that the A through L are essentially identical to the state act. But town meeting wants them there anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll do that.
I think it's a good baseline reiteration of what the document's trying to do. Anything from your perspective? All right. Well, why don't we go ahead and open it up for public comment. Any questions, comments, concerns with the purpose that's been drafted? No? All right. So I guess we need a motion?
Move through.
Or, what do we do? No.
So you would close the public hearing, and then you would make a recommendation to town meeting.
Okay.
Right. Move that the CPDC close the public hearing for the proposed zoning amendment to Section 1 purpose.
Second.
All those in favor?
Move that the CPDC recommend the content of the zoning change proposal to town meeting.
Second.
All those in favor? Good.
All right.
That's pretty easy. So that'll be on the warrant for November. Next we have, Can we start?
I've
got 7:41.
Yeah, you have 4 minutes.
4 minutes.
Well.
Yeah, I guess I
didn't.
You should wait.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, just.
Don't rely on that.
Yeah.
Did you get the pictures I sent you?
Yes, I did. And you know
what?
Dave took some Dave sent some pictures of Dr. Raven. How nice it's turning out, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's looking really, really good.
Really good.
Have you seen it?
No, it's a grab by.
I'll forward you Dave's pictures.
Yeah.
Right.
It's looking really, really nice.
I mean, the result looks really good.
I was either going to work or coming back during one of those torrential downpours, and that thing was filled right to the brim. It wasn't overflowing. Yeah.
The new parking lot?
It took it all, so it was all in there. It was full.
How the rain garden work?
Well, it's dry and drained now, so I guess it did.
That's a good test, yeah.
Yeah.
Are there any general updates to provide?
Conradi Tavern is open.
Yeah,
yep.
Conradi Tavern is open.
Stopped in there for the night. Pretty busy.
Mm-hmm. And cool. I mean, Grumpy's has folded up there. Some of my son's friends got some of the leftovers. So we've got a refrigerator full of
them. That's great.
Rolls, and we had steak tips and so on and so forth from Grumpy
yeah.
Doyle's.
Nice.
Yeah, the owner for the MF Charles building will be coming back
at
some point for the upper floors. So they're ironing out how they want to proceed with the project
mm-hmm.
from a permitting standpoint, whether or not to submit all under Smart Growth or just do the second floor build out under the base zoning first, sort of phase it again, but it's ultimately,
mm-hmm.
you know, their decision on how they want to do it, but they will be back probably within the next month or two.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the recycle bin is in.
That's
okay.
Great.
Did they put it in the location?
I can watch it from my window.
Great. Everything. That's quite a view.
That sounds like really good. You can watch the recycling bin from your window.
Yeah.
Well, it's to guard against the insertion of improper materials.
I don't know if I can control that, but I can certainly observe.
Right.
So far, so good, as far as we know.
Yeah. We're going to have some sort of fancy ribbon cutting or something.
Really?
Ribbon disposal.
Cardboard ribbon?
Yeah. Something about donuts as part of the festivities.
That's key. Beautiful.
Okay.
So I have on the phone 7:45.
All right, so do I. All right. Good. All right, so Nick, you want to read the legal notice for the Act for Protection
sure.
Issue?
Pursuant to Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 48, Section 5, Adoption or Change of Zoning Ordinances or Bylaw, notice is hereby given at the Reading Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, June 29th, 2015 at 7:45 in the Selectman's Meeting Room of the Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to discuss the proposed zoning amendment to Section 10.3, Aquifer Protection District and associated amendments to Section 2.0, Definitions, Section 3.4.1, Lots in Two Districts, and Section 3.2, Zoning Map. Complete text relative to the proposed amendments and more information are available for public inspection between 7:30 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. Monday through Thursday and until 7 p.m. on Tuesdays in the Community Services Department at Reading Town Hall.
Great, thank you. So Jesse's gonna, again, walk us through a brief presentation on what the Aquifer Protection District does, what its purpose is, and summarize some of the changes that have been made to the draft.
All right. So just some basic notes here. We wanted to sort of get back to basics on what an aquifer is and our definition that is in the bylaw. It's a geological formation of composed of rock, sand, or gravel that contains significant amounts of potentially recoverable water. Why do we need an aquifer protection overlay district regulated by zoning? While it's required for DEP for the protection of our drinking water supply, and it's basically triggered by the fact that we have the wells. Our zoning has it as an overlay district that regulates new constructions or construction additions to existing buildings. So many people ask, well, we don't use our wells for drinking water, so why do we still do this? We have an administrative consent order that tells us that we're required to have it as emergency water supply. So the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection requirements, these are sort of their purpose identified for the Aquifer Protection District and is carried over into our bylaw for the purpose. So what is the Aquifer Protection District? It's essentially a land area that allows for groundwater recharge into our public drinking water supply. Any town or city that has wells, we're required to have it. So our Aquifer Protection District was identified through a study from Weston and Sampson done in 1996 and approved on a bylaw map dated December 2002. So here are the boundaries. This map is the official map. It's a little bit challenging to orientate yourself, so I put up a couple points of interest. So the Reading side of this is on the right-hand side of the map, sort of in this area. So here's downtown, Route 28 sort of goes right through here. This is Lowell Street here, and the Ipswich River is this line here that goes right through here. So in Reading, our Aquifer Protection District is here, this area. And just to put this in perspective of our zoning map, it's this blue hatched area that goes all the way through here. This zoning map is available on our website. So just to go through some of the changes, we are updating the definition section. We're moving all the definitions into section 2.0, which is our definition section of the bylaw. We're adding a new definition for underground storage tank, landfill, and open dump. The definition of impervious surface is updated, and we also revised the definition of earth removal. And we did delete some definitions based on our recommendation by council that weren't really necessary. We do have a definition, if some of you recall last November, we did move some definitions up to section 2 already, and toxic and hazardous material was moved up. It's just called hazardous material in section 2.0, so that's also a change. The scope and authority, it was moved into a new subsection, 10.3.1. I think some of you have a copy of the language. I won't go into details of that, but essentially, we sort of reorganized it, made it a little bit more simple to understand between the scope and authority and the establishment of and delineation of the Aquifer Protection District. We deleted boundary disputes, and I'm going to go into a little bit on why we did that. The impervious area threshold, no changes to the threshold amount, but we did clarify for its portions of lots that are within the district. There are some lots that are half in the district, half not in the district, or just a portion in the district. The district is going to apply to that portion of the parcel that's within the district. We also clarify that recharge systems allowed are those that are called out in the design standards of the stormwater regulations. We also are proposing to delete the current subsection 10.3.7. That's covered under section 7 of our bylaw. That's non-conforming. That was also a recommendation from council that we have sort of these two sections that address the same thing. It's better to have it just identified in our section 7 dealing specifically with those uses. And then we also deleted the violation notice. It's also covered in another section of our bylaw under enforcement. So why did we delete the boundary disputes? If the map is believed to be interpreted incorrectly by our building inspector, so if you come in and you've got the map and you're looking at the map and you're saying one thing and the building inspector is saying another thing, the typical route to address that dispute would be the Board of Appeals. If you have a concern with the actual boundary of the district, if you believe the boundary itself is incorrect based on the conditions, then the ultimate body to review that would be DEP. And then, so why did we delete the non-conforming uses and structures? Essentially, all legal pre-existing legal non-conforming uses and structures are regulated under Section 7 of our bylaw. Only if there's an increase in the non-conforming nature of the parcel, in this case, the impervious area, would one be required to comply with the new standards. And some other changes that we made, which we feel are sort of improvements from the current language, we clarify the applicability for the portions of lots that are within the district currently. It's not really clear in the language. And then we also allow for other forms of recharge other than artificial systems, such as rain gardens. Those, essentially, anything identified in the DEP stormwater design guidelines can be used as long as they meet the requirements. So it gives a homeowner a little bit more flexibility, and it clarifies that they have that ability to do so. And that's what I have.
All right, great, thanks. So I recall when we were having the public forums, the Zoning Advisory Committee got a lot of feedback on this section of the bylaw. They felt it was very onerous, difficult to understand, a lot of potentially conflicting requirements with the broader zoning bylaw. So we've done a lot of work on it, and I just want to kind of call out a lot of partnerships that were that occurred between the Zoning Advisory Committee, CPDC, town staff, town council, engineering, the DEP, the MWRA. A lot of work was done to get this to a point where we could still fit within the confines of the consent order, but not have sort of a heavy hand on the residents of this district, or this overlay district. So I think we've landed at a pretty good spot. Anybody from the board have any comments on Aquifer Protection District?
Well, I have. I don't like the definitions or treatment of the underground storage tanks, because I think it's at best awkward, if not very hard to understand or subject to challenge. I think we need to tune up the wording and the treatment of it. And we've been trying, and it started by the Zoning Advisory Committee, aiming for definitions that are simply definitions, and putting regulatory constraints or exclusions in the regulatory portions of the bylaw.
Yeah, we're still defining what it's not.
Yes.
And we're also using the word of the title in the definition. Right? Underground storage tank. Any underground tank. Makes no sense.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that word was taken out.
So if we wanted to continue to work on this definition, can we do that or as part of our ongoing meetings, or would it have to be done on before town meeting?
You could do it now.
Yeah, we could do it now.
You would have better than that. You can put it in your recommendations. We don't need to make your recommendation until November.
Okay. Yeah, this is definitely something. I know we've spoken about this a few times, and I think we're still not at a point where we're happy with that definition. I assume this is a term that's probably defined in other bylaws. Can we check what other towns have?
That's the statutory definition.
That's the statutory definition. Okay.
Statutory definition includes the exception.
Yes.
Hmm. Interesting.
And it also does the offending thing of using the word underground. Always the problem is when you've got a statutory definition. You write something different.
Mm-hmm.
You're inviting somebody to say, well, you must have meant something different. So if you take out the word underground out of that, you're inviting somebody to say, oh, well, you took it out for a substantive reason rather than a grammatical reason.
Sure. Sure.
I would agree if that's all we did.
Mm-hmm.
But if the definition change, because it's more than just changing underground, it's the whole idea of defining what it's not, I think is as much of a problem in our context as just the fact that it says underground tank
content
to describe an underground storage tank. So if you change the whole thing, you can't pinpoint and say, oh, you must have meant something different about underground. Like it.
Dave just proposed this definition. I'll just read it out loud. Underground storage tank, any storage tank or container with all or a portion of the contents located beneath the surface of the ground.
Period.
Period.
And then obviously the exclusions, or you know, the permissiveness would go in the rest of the zoning bylaw.
Okay. Well, let's hold on to that. I don't think we necessarily have to solve it today, but
right.
I think that's.
And just, you know, until we solve it, I'll keep bringing it up.
Yeah.
There you go.
The term isn't used anywhere else in the zoning bylaw, so that's a good thing.
It's not.
No, it isn't.
Oh, well.
So that's a good thing. It's only used in this section. There's fundamentally no reason why we can't do it the way Dave says. As long as every time we use the term, we remind ourselves that our definition of us is different from the state's. I don't think, as long as we include that exclusion in the substantive part, I don't think DEP will object. But you know, I mean, one of the steps remaining is to take whatever we do and run it by DEP again. At the end of the day, we're going to want to make sure that they're not going to have a problem.
So is that
DEP finds problems in places where you and I might not.
That's their job.
Yeah. So fundamentally, you're not changing the logic. You're not changing the substance of it. You're just changing the logic of it. And
right.
I don't think there's any.
Or introducing logic, some might say.
But anyhow, that's, you know, lawyers never want to do anything original. They always just want to copy. And so
they don't charge you for that, though. They charge you as though they're doing it original.
They're certainly not going to comment on
that. As a lawyer, right.
So, I mean, the point is, if there's a tried and true way of doing things, on some level, it's safer. You know, you're not going to run into any trouble with this. But we've got months ahead of us.
Right.
And if you want to change it, we'll change it. And then when we run it by DEP, we'll see if they balk. If they balk, then we'll deal with it.
Okay.
Is that the biggest challenge we face? Is DEP's review of it? Or
well, I don't. You, I, I think.
I mean, I'm just thinking
the biggest legal challenge?
Yeah.
Yeah, I assume your biggest challenge is getting this past town meeting.
Yeah, no, I understand that. But I mean, assuming that it all goes through, if this becomes our bylaw and that, and our revised definition is within the zoning bylaw,
mm-hmm.
by changing that definition, it doesn't necessarily change the intent of what we're trying to accomplish here. So I'm just trying to think a few steps ahead. Would there be any interpretation challenges that we have? Or
I can't imagine that there would be.
Okay. All right, so
we'll
keep backing at it.
So, we can, you know, we can easily make that change.
Yeah.
And nobody objects, then it's fine.
So, Ray, if I could just chime in about the logistics, whatever gets voted on tonight,
mm-hmm.
assuming it does, the even if what's presented were printed in the warrant, the report by the CPDC to town meeting is always sort of the last bite of this.
Sure, but look, we've got a lot of extra time here, so we should take advantage of it. Whatever you decide on tonight, we'll make the changes. We'll get it in front of DEP. They'll tell us what we what they object to. The last time, the last round, we got some comments from DEP that were a little unorthodox, shall I say. And we then took them to the Attorney General because a couple of them were, the Attorney General will never approve this. And so then we talked to the Attorney General's office and we made some adjustments and some we didn't. And
we don't have to close the public hearing tonight either.
Or close it, I don't care. Because the point is you don't have to issue your report now. So we can do all of that other stuff and we can.
So can I interject?
Yeah.
So what gets put in the warrant?
Will get voted in September.
Oh, okay, to approve it for the warrant, okay.
Is that in September?
Yeah,
usually
you have
go to print fairly early.
No,
I would say you would want to have that by the end of September, no, at the latest, because we go to print far in advance of November, whatever it is.
Yeah.
You know, like
why don't you just write this the way
yeah,
we want to?
I was
going to
say
yeah.
that. Put that in the warrant, and then if the DEP objects, our report will reflect that change.
Yeah.
We'll put that on the floor.
And then you can take this version, hand it off to DEP for their input.
Mm-hmm.
Let's do that. You want to hand that on?
Sure.
Hand it off to Jesse. All right. Any storage tank or container with all or a portion of the content
or contents, I guess.
Okay, of the contents, plural, located beneath the surface of the ground. And then I think the
you want to say with all or
I'm just gonna go in the final to see how that looks. Any sort of
yeah.
tank or container.
Yeah. Any portion of the content.
Either. Located beneath the surface of the ground. And then all of this would get
then we want to move that.
Find the right place for the rest of it.
Okay. Probably.
Which is around
down there in the list of prohibited things.
Yeah.
I think it's the last thing of prohibited items, last item.
Yeah, item F.
Or would it be
the very last one?
Yeah, I think that's where we were. Containing those of his material. permitted by section 10331 of the zoning bylaw except for liquid propane products and installed and used in accordance.
Alright, so take the sentence and just stick it at the end for the moment.
Yep.
Okay.
It shouldn't say the term.
Yeah, right, we have to fix that. These are, just so we're clear, these are the prohibited uses. So, where you have the cursor now.
Yep.
Change that period to a semicolon. And add, provided comma however. Comma.
Paste.
That this prohibition shall not apply to, and then jump down to a storage tank or container and situate in the underground area. Voila.
Yeah.
How's that?
Much better.
Okay.
You heard listen to Dave Harper on this.
That's what pushed me over the other side. He said he'd bring it up every time. So in that case, let's fix it now. And just okay. All right, good.
Any other comments from the board on this bylaw?
Can you just go back to that one more second?
Yes.
Sure.
This is essentially allowing the fuel, the heating fuel. Thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right, Jane? Everything? All right.
Basically, yeah, the wording is a little tricky, but I think it's okay.
Yeah.
Just trying to think if it could be simpler, but.
Oh, you want simpler?
It is tough, but it reads, and it's their definition, right?
Yeah.
So maybe they'll have less objection to it. Since we really just we didn't change it, we just moved it.
That's exactly what we will tell them.
That's how we get to a zoning bylaw that is not understandable by anyone.
Yeah.
But lawyers. The point of the whole last year's effort being to try and make a zoning bylaw that people could actually understand. So then when we include stuff like this, you can make your way through it and understand it, but it doesn't scream out, oh, you mean your oil tank, right?
Exactly.
There's a resolution. Because in essence, zoning bylaws are legal.
What you're trying to say is above ground tanks are okay.
Underground tanks that are in your basement are okay. Elsewhere in here, we say above ground tanks are okay.
Right.
Any other comments?
As long as it's above
the
floor.
Yeah.
If it's not above the floor, then it's at the point is
if it's buried
if it's buried in any way, then it's a threat to the to the aquifer. If it's completely enclosed within the cellar and above the floor, if it leaks, the only thing that's going to get damaged is your cellar, not the aquifer. This isn't a cellar protection bylaw. This is an aquifer protection bylaw.
Can we call it the cellar paragraph?
I mean, do we want to try to? Or is it not worth it?
I think it's better than it was, and it still works.
Okay. Fine. You're right about that, John?
The new fuel code require double containment? The lines certainly, if they're buried, have to be double contained.
Mm-hmm.
And even if they're above grade, they should be double contained. But I'm wondering if tanks are now double contained. Mm-hmm. I have an old tank, but I know if I buy a new one, it'll be a stainless steel tank with a plastic liner of some sort.
I think that is the requirement now.
Yeah. So there's a lot more regulation behind that than just us talking.
Yes. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's a good
word. I mean, the thing is that the change avoids the thing of the underground tank that isn't an underground tank.
I'm with you on that.
Yeah. Because if you bury a propane tank in the ground, that's okay.
That's because propane, if it leaks.
Yes, I know.
Doesn't go into the groundwater.
I'm just commenting on the fact that we spent a year trying to make the zoning bylaw more simple and easy to understand, and we're making another change, and we're not making it more simple and easy to understand. It's commentary. It's not meant to say that we should change it, because we could be here for hours trying to wordsmith.
Yeah.
And they get challenged by DEP, say, oh, why don't you use our words? Because
we
like them better. We
like our words better.
Yeah, I have no interest in that battle.
Okay. The rest of it looked good.
Okay. We're going to open it up for public comment. Any comments from the public on the aquifer protection district?
Principal comments.
Tony DeRosa, 130 John Street. I'm questioning whether you actually even needed the extra that you put on section N, as you already had the exception for liquid propane products for normal household use and installed using accordance to all the applicable local, state, and federal laws. That sounds like an exemption for an in-basement heating tank, if you're trying to go for simpler.
Mm-hmm.
Having said that, I have one other comment. Section 10.3.3.1i, under the new number.
Hold on, let me catch up. 10.3.3.1i.
I think that's what it is.
Okay.
It should be the land uses.
Yep.
Is that section supposed to take into account lots that border two districts, in effect? Part in the aquifer and part outside, as opposed to the old, which had a 50% or whatever ruling?
It should not, right? We've got rid of the lots in two districts as it relates to this.
This applies to a portion of the lot that's located within the district.
I think under the original rules, if the lot was 50% within the district, the entire lot applied?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You change that.
Okay.
So now it's only the portion that's within the district would need to adhere to these regulations.
I would recommend to the board that they make that very clear to the town meeting. I believe that was always a sticking point.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that.
And you want to make it clear, using that language, you could make it clear by on the second line where you see where it says the total amount of impervious surface on the lot. So wait, second line.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Right there. You could make it clearer by saying, you know, it says it later. Total amount of impervious surface on the lot within the district.
Yeah. And in fact, you could probably strike out the on the lot. Is alter a lot such that the total amount of impervious surface within the district?
No, it has to be on the lot. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're measuring
the entire district.
The entire district.
We'll leave
everything,
for a lawyer.
I mean,
okay.
You're already well over 2,500 square feet within the district. But that would be clear. Let's do that.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, okay.
And Tony, for your first comment, I'd recommend we keep that language only because I think part of the reason we want to keep it is that straight from the DEP definition. We just pulled it out of the definition, revised it. We felt that it may make DEP a little bit more happy if we actually had that language somewhere in the bylaw.
And the propane tanks are often not within the cellar, they're above ground, and so they're excluded. They're partially
right.
Underground, but outside. It's not often that you would find a propane tank inside the cellar.
Well, in most cases, actually, like we had over at the church, there's a vault outside. And it's in the underground, but they're in a protected vault over by the Killam School, I guess it was, or the church next to it.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Karen Herrick, 9 Vince Road. Brianna, I want to ask you about. So the whole underground storage tank with propane. I know it's in there, but I got to read like all the stuff to find it. I was wondering if it would make sense to move it to a positive permitted use. Underground storage tanks containing non-hazardous materials like liquid propane. I think when we made this change to the bylaw too, there was some discussion that there may be some underground water storage tanks, and it's sort of alluded to in the bylaw that might be okay, but I feel like this is still hard to read because it's kind of, it's all over the place. So I would say if I was coming to the building inspector and I wanted to say, hey, I'm building a new house or I'm changing propane, can I bury my tank? He has to read through all the permitted uses, it's not in there, and he has to read through, and consumers, the residents, have to read through everything. It's like an exception buried in there. So and I helped put it there because that was just easy, but I might suggest that it should be like a positive thing. And then let's say I had a question. So the whole impervious materials, and Jesse, you might know better. So are we allowing residents, does DEP allow residents, or they get a specific to say, when we're looking at impervious surface, you can look at impervious pavers, because some of the residents have gotten pushed back when trying to meet these kind of requirements. I certainly know what DEP lists everywhere. I was wondering if anybody did.
This is the definition used by DEP.
So that.
Ours was a little bit more restrictive.
Yeah, okay. So does that say to anybody in the room that I can't meet my requirement by installing pervious pavers? So pervious pavers or pervious pavement, sorry. It wouldn't to me, but I know in the past if a resident tried to do it, they might get pushed back.
And then, either pervious or impervious. In the past, I don't think the building inspector allowed it for a number of reasons. We were stricter, but also because what's going to happen is they'll put their pervious pavement walkway around back, and then the next owner will just pave over that.
That's exactly what we've heard. It's really, it assumes everybody's out to like do the wrong thing.
Well, the issue is you don't need a permit to pave, so it's not necessarily everyone's out to do the wrong thing. It's that there is no process for someone to, if you don't know, that to say, oh, well, yeah, I know it's impervious pavers now, but 5 years from now, I'm just going to put pavement down because it's cheaper and it's easier.
I mean, people do things anyway. Things happen.
Yeah.
This doesn't even allow the homeowner, like we're limited to, if DEP doesn't say this is bad, and maybe this doesn't get decided here, but I think it's gonna continue to come up because it doesn't say, DEP doesn't say you can't use impervious things, but the town always pushes back because you're afraid somebody's gonna do the wrong thing like 20 years down.
But in this definition, that's not, it's, if it's impervious, it's, in, it's if they're pervious pavers, then
they're, okay.
They're pervious pavers and they're okay.
They're okay.
That distinction.
Eliminated that roadblock.
Yeah.
Okay, and then the other thing I was just trying to ask, and I don't know all of the laws, so I can't refer to the whatever chapters. Do we allow septic systems in the aquifer district? We may have a couple now. Have we, does anywhere in here say that we can't or we can, because it does refer to some other state law? Because those would involve tanks.
Good question.
Well, it's specifically, it's item G, which prohibits storage of sludge and septic unless such storage
yeah.
is in compliance with 310 CMR, et cetera.
So that's what I didn't know what those were, so I thought, I didn't know if those were referring to, you know, acceptable Title V systems. If it is, then
I'll
I don't think we're prohibiting it.
Bow to our legal advice here.
Which requires me to find what you just said. What did you just say?
What's this one right up here?
It is the former 1036247.
That provision is not intended to prohibit septic systems, which are not really storage systems. It does, and those regulations are not the Title V regulations. So I believe that as it sits, the bylaw is completely silent about septic.
So your point about water, it specifically says that other facilities for drinking water supply wells without some bottles.
Yeah, I kind of saw that. I feel like it's just, and I know they didn't make major revisions to this, so it's kind of scattered everywhere.
I think if you look at the final document of all the edits, it's a little simpler. But specifically on the prohibited uses, it talks about liquid hazardous materials. And so, you know, a rain collection system would not be a liquid hazardous system.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if propane is considered a hazardous material.
It's on that
mm-hmm.
list. That's kind of where we want
yeah.
to exercise.
But it may be a hazardous material, but it's still related to home heating uses, and those are exempt as long as the tank is installed properly.
The reason that we're specifically call that out is because propane tanks are okay even if they are completely underground and not in a cellar. But I mean, the idea that you can take that and make it into an affirmative statement and put it into permitted uses, I think is fine. If that it, I don't see any reason why we can't do that. We just have to then just end so that it says underground storage tanks containing hazardous materials other than liquid propane. You pretty much would have to leave
stop
almost all of that. No. I'm just thinking you could say except as permitted in, you know, you put a new section up there that permits it, in the permitted section, that permits underground storage tanks containing liquid propane products for normal household and installed, da 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 da. You take that part and you put it up in the permitted part. And then down here you just say, except as permitted under subsection, whatever subsection we just created,
do that, if that,
yeah,
that would make people.
Let's try that.
That is.
Let's try. Okay, so take the sentence, let's do this. Take the sentence that says underground storage tanks, that whole sentence, all the way down to the provided. No, get rid of not including provided. Don't erase it, just copy it. Okay? And now let's go up to the permitted uses. And we'll add a new one at the end. Okay?
J.
I like the letter.
You like the letter? Okay. Okay. Well, good. I'm glad we got that taken care of. Okay. So then you say underground storage tanks containing, and then get rid of everything up all the way down to liquid propane products.
And just remove
storage tanks containing liquid propane products for normal household use.
Comma, strike the and. Perhaps.
I would like it to say that are installed.
Installed.
No, comma.
Tanks that are installed.
Yeah. So. Use comma that are installed. Maybe don't need a comma. No, we'll leave it because, yeah. Yes. Okay, so that's your new J. And then, under here, you begin this by saying, except as provided in, so ahead of underground.
Except as permitted in.
Except as permitted in, that's right.
10.3.1.
Not even by.
10.
Section. We've been writing out the word section. Now, does anybody know what section
10.3.3.1.
J. It's a comma. Underground storage tanks. Underground storage tanks containing toxic hazardous materials.
So to his point.
Related activities permitted in section.
Well, 10.3.6.1 is all of the permitted uses.
Yeah, I don't
think. Or 10.3.3.1.
Why don't we just say underground storage tanks containing toxic and hazardous materials?
Well, we're just saying hazardous.
That's right, hazardous materials, right. And then we can jump, put a semicolon after materials.
Mm-hmm.
And we can jump all the way down to provided.
Yeah. Okay.
Wow. This one's
that one.
Can people see?
To delete all this?
Yeah.
Specifically, this is what we're looking at.
Okay.
So there, have we made it simpler?
Mm-hmm.
Well, just read it. I can't read the result here.
Let me zoom in.
Okay.
Go back to this
one. Oh, wait a minute. Just
does this cover oil tanks? Is
nope.
So oil tanks are still
down
here.
Here.
Okay.
A lot of words, but it says the right thing.
Makes clear propane tanks too.
Because they got
yeah.
their very own paragraph. Just for that.
And does this help with your concern around propane
yeah,
tanks?
Yeah, I think making it a positive will just make
yeah.
it everybody it easier for people to actually find it.
Good. Why do you need that semicolon? That's confusing.
Because if you're introducing the provided, however, that. So it's.
I don't know. Why wouldn't you reverse that first sentence? Underground storage tank containing toxic and hazardous material. I mean, containing hazardous material except as permitted by section 10.3.3.1. Why are you leading with that?
That's you
do that too.
Yeah.
It's just that then it becomes a flag for underground storage tanks right away.
Yeah,
okay.
You might see it faster.
Alright.
Just do that.
Do that.
Okay, so
start the sentence move that part up to the beginning.
Much better.
Oh, hold on.
I love the semicolon.
Do you want to go back to here?
Yeah, and then Karen, for the other item that you brought up, under the CMRs, the Code of Mass Regulation, is that what, sludge is what comes out of a wastewater plant. Septage is what we all think of, but those particular CMRs are actually related to storage, not septic tanks. So like porta potty companies that store it for a while, that's what all of those are talking about, storage and then disposal. So not really septic systems. So
the bylaw is completely silent about septic systems.
Right. But if you want to store it for some reason, then that's what we want to prohibit.
Yes.
It's a good thing to prohibit.
Well, given that we opened the barn door here, is it appropriate to add a clause to the permitted uses for septic system domestic?
No. Way too complicated.
Yeah.
Okay.
We don't even know what those regulations are.
Yeah, it comes with its own.
It's the right question to ask.
We could create some monster.
But I don't like monsters, nonetheless.
Any other questions, Karen?
No.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to go to Angela first.
Angela Benda, I just have a question. Why would 10.3.9 remove the violation notice? Does that move somewhere else? Or
that's
all
under.
All the violations are dealt with in a single place.
In a single place. And is the context, is the content of it the same? The same procedures?
Actually, I think this was a little quirky. This actually makes it harder, it makes it more administratively cumbersome for the building inspector to enforce because it requires him to give notice to a whole lot of other people. And it also requires them to act, I don't even want to go there, as soon as possible after detection of a violation.
This is the version in
this is
our current?
This is what we took out.
Okay. Yep.
I don't know why we need to exalt this violation above all others and say this is what we have a special procedure for enforcing this provision that is different from our general provision.
Sure.
That just seems like an invitation for conflict. So one enforcement procedure for everything seems like a sensible way.
Mm-hmm.
Will we be dealing with that section at the same time?
No, I think we've
done already.
Section 4,
administration.
Okay, so this is included in that, or it's not? So will the Conservation Commission still be notified?
No.
Okay. Is that notified?
That doesn't mean that they won't be notified. It just means that we, by putting a requirement in here that the Conservation Commission be notified, means that if he fails to notify the Conservation Commission, then the whole violation notice is improper.
Yeah.
You don't want to do that. Have special hoops to jump through just for this. I think we can rely on our staff to enforce
right.
these things in a fair way. I don't know that there's any reluctance on anybody's part to let the Conservation Commission know if there's a problem that might affect something that they're
sure.
or is within their jurisdiction.
Generally, we do that now whenever there is a violation that affects a different board. I mean, commonly zoning violation, health code violations go hand in hand. We always copy the appropriate person on the notice.
But putting it in as a requirement just means you'll open yourself up to challenge if somebody doesn't notice it. And in this case, it requires notice. One thing that's weird about what was there is that the building inspector is the one giving the notice, but a copy of the notice has to be submitted to the building inspector. That's a little weird anyway. Not everything that is a violation is going to turn out to be something that's relevant to the Board of Health or to the DPW or the Water Department. Most, some things will, but some things won't. And if somebody fails to give notice, and then that means that the whole enforcement proceeding could end up having to be tossed out and started over. And we don't want to do that.
Okay.
In section 4, so it's in section.
Okay. Yeah, we have a full brand new enforcement section that was adopted last year that makes this clear.
Any other questions or comments?
No, thank you.
Sure. Anybody else that hasn't spoken? I know, Tony, I think you have another.
Because I enjoy beating dead horses.
As do I.
In section 10, where you have the exception, provided however this prohibition shall not apply to storage tanks, did you want to move that up into section 10.331J, since you already now have a section of permitted uses? And reword it to be permissible?
I was actually thinking, not to put it into J, but I was actually thinking, as long as we're being so affirmative, why not take that this prohibition shall not apply and make it 10.331K, and then all we have, we can just change this to say as permitted by section 10.331J and K. Take the whole provided, however, out of here, get rid of that semicolon.
I'm all for it.
Okay, so you just need a J, right? Okay, so now we have a K, all right, and then we just say storage, so get rid of however that this prohibition shall not apply to, you start with storage tanks. Change it to plural, capital S, to plural, storage tanks or containers. Okay, so now that's a permitted use.
And now we go back down to here.
Right. And then we get rid of everything there except you just want to say, as permitted by section 10.3.3.1J or K. Yeah. Look at that. How could anything be clearer than that?
That's where I was trying to get to.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Any other comments? Okay, to close the public hearing?
Move that the CPDC close the public hearing for the zoning amendment to section 10.3 aquifer protection district and the associated definition changes.
Second.
All those in favor?
So is this what we're going to recommend, or should we wait to hear from DEP to see if we have any changes and then have them review that again?
I don't know why you would vote to make a recommendation this early.
Okay.
I mean, if you vote now, you may be asked to at some point to vote again.
Mm-hmm.
But to my way of thinking, we've fiddled with this enough that we ought to give DEP another whack at it, see if they have it. If they're going to freak out on us. If they do, then we'll have to.
Have
to see whether we can.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. We don't vote.
Unless we want.
I mean, you can vote, but if you want to vote, that's a good thing. If you just understand that. You might be asked to vote again.
Yeah. If DEP objects to the structure that we put in there, but not necessarily the content, we could still go to the AG with it.
Oh well, yeah. I mean,
we have
two hurdles here. We go to the DEP, and last time we did this, the DEP said, "Oh, the Attorney General won't like this at all." And so I said, "Really? Well, let's give the Attorney General a call and find out." They actually had no objection to it at all. So it's two steps. You got to make sure that at the end of the day, it's the Attorney General that has to approve this. They will ask DEP, but as long as they've already told us that it's okay,
mm-hmm.
then it doesn't matter if DEP freaks out on that. Let them listen.
Yeah.
Yeah. It won't matter, they're all going to be fine.
Well, I think it's fair to say that we want the town staff to push this to the appropriate review. That probably doesn't take a vote. Or it doesn't require a vote.
If there are substantial changes that need to be made, then we'll bring it back to
you. We'll let you know.
Yeah.
Okay. First, we'll fight them, and then if we do it, then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. So, no vote?
Not right now.
Okay, that's fine. All right. Okay, well, thank you, everybody. You're more than welcome to stick around, talk about telecommunication. Next on our agenda,
person said, but you know, I'm retiring on June 30th.
Uh-huh.
That's
great.
Part of that early retirement window?
Yeah. So, great. So, anything you say is
irrelevant.
Could you please connect me with someone who actually will be here after that first session?
The answer is, I don't know who that will be.
I don't know who that is, yeah.
State agency in the coming month or two.
All right, so next up on the agenda, review the direct language for the telecommunications bylaw.
In your packets, I did sort of create a matrix on some other bylaws.
Yeah, so that was good.
To find. They kind of are all over the place in the way they do things.
But that's good. It kind of gives us a menu.
It does.
So, just to kind of rehash where we were, there were five major areas of decisioning that we had to work through. We've gone through two, and we wanted to go through today and complete the last three, which are... height and setback, special permit requirements, and the application procedure. Mm-hmm. But before we do that, I had a question. I did not see in the version that I was reviewing where it spells out that the CPDC is the special permit granting authority.
So in the draft article that Ray had provided, it would be a table of uses revision. And we would have it be SPP.
Oh, okay, okay.
But we could certainly make that clear in the language.
I might want to add that. Now, I mean, is that appropriate that the CPDC serve in that capacity, or is it more appropriate for the...
ZBA.
ZBA.
I'm agnostic on this point. Many towns, many planning boards have in their mind, when they're allocating special permit granting authority, they have some internal rule that they think makes sense. So, for example, in Hopkinton, any special permit that sort of looks like site plan approval, they keep. Anything else they give to the ZBA.
Okay.
But in another town that I won't mention because of what I'm about to say, they never want to give anything, the planning board never wants to keep anything for itself. Because
it's work,
exactly. So they're more than happy to give special permit granting authority off to the ZBA, or in that town, a lot of it is retained by, is given to the board of selectmen. Something that I'm pretty sure you don't want to do.
Right.
So when we went through the table of uses, that the first one that Ray mentioned was exactly what we had talked about, if I remember correctly, is anything that gets into site plan type of issues. It only makes sense to stay here if it doesn't touch site plan type issues, then it would make more sense for ZBA.
Yeah.
Well, but we also have the I think reasonably explicit policy that if it requires a special permit and a site review of some kind, then it should be handled by a single board.
I don't think it should be ZBA because it can't be prohibited. So if they come in with a power, it's going somewhere, we might as well work through the site plan review charade, whatever you want to call it.
If only I had pearls to clutch.
Look, this is our telecommunications 40B, basically. you know, they're gonna come in, if they really wanna force their hand, they can. We've outlined all these parameters that we think make it better, give us some say, but ultimately we might not have this. So ZBA doesn't really get involved in that, you know,
right.
It's permitted.
Yeah.
Right.
Board of Selectmen, they can voice their opinion if they want. But if they did, it would still go through the site
plan right.
portion of it and then give them
right.
the information.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I agree. I just, it's a trick. We had the conversation specific to this bylaw, but
yeah.
I think we're all in agreement, so that's fine. But maybe we should spell it out a little bit more explicitly in the bylaw itself, in addition to the table of uses.
Ray, we would want to also make sure that we delete this. This is our old.
Yes, in the table of uses.
So we probably want to revise.
That is true, and that is a defined term, as I would call commercial communication structures, even though when we read it, we said we don't know what that means. And someone had to tell us that that means cell towers.
And therefore, should we delete that from the definitions?
Yes.
Do we have to run through the code to see if it's mentioned anywhere?
Sure.
I mean, it's listening, it looks like several times in the table.
Well, it's listed like twice. Right?
That one can be deleted.
Sections, we're deleting that. We said delete the entirety. Section, and that's just in the history.
Yeah. All right. It's pretty clean.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about special permit requirements. Start with the visual guidelines. A number of.
Well, before we get beyond the first page, the first preference in the desk packet draft says entirely within business A, business B, and business C. And I was under the impression that we had restricted it to business A, business C, and industrial, or that we had intended to, you know, exclude business B from the first preference.
Yeah, you're right.
The first page of the new draft.
This is what I've got. No,
I don't know. I don't see what you're.
I don't know. I'm just
you're talking about this memo.
I'm talking about this thing, which is in my desk.
Oh, that's the consideration document that we were working off of. So we did work through that first area.
This is the actual.
Oh, okay.
I would. This is the text, but I had drafted sort of an outline for CBDC things that we got to work through, consider that. Yeah, I mean, the first document, this CBDC consideration is what people have done work through it.
Yeah.
Just Jesse, we have two versions of this.
One
is a red line, and one's just clean. Okay.
Okay. Never mind.
All right, so you've got the preferences as far as structures go. Then we've got the general special permit requirements, which is 5.6.3.2.
Mm-hmm.
The question that I had, if you look at demonstration of need B, need for service, the applicant must demonstrate the service objectives in the town of Reading that the proposed PWSF will address in whole or in part. Why or in part? Wouldn't we want to understand the full scope and all the needs that are needing to be addressed?
Well, I think that what that is intended to mean is that the particular thing in front of you might not be intended to address all of the needs of the town, but only a part of the needs.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So, nobody's even going to ever use any of this. But but in most towns, the cell towers are located in such a way that way over on the other side of town, things are not so good.
Right.
So they have to identify that. But maybe one more tower isn't going to do the trick. Maybe they actually have more than one more tower, but this will help some.
Okay.
The fact that Reading is somewhat surrounded by interstate highways, that we're probably some of the first to be have this is, seems to me to be something that was 10 years ago issue in terms of new coverage, not necessarily co-location and all those types of issues
and
evolving needs.
Well,
as we move forward, it seems to me that when we started writing cell tower bylaws, the companies kept saying, in 10 years, it will all be satellite, and we won't need any of this stuff. But
yeah, and they're completely wrong. But that's other than that.
So, 10 years is coming and gone, and we're still doing cell towers.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the 600 millisecond barrier.
But I mean, that is an important fact, is that this requires them to demonstrate that there's an actual need that this is being addressed and that need is located in the town of Reading. So no fair putting a cell tower in our town that's primarily designed to remedy a problem in a different town.
Mm-hmm.
Well, unless it works, unless they can go into, remember, at the end of the day, they could come in here and ask you for a waiver of that requirement because they say there is no place in North Reading where this can go. It has to go in Reading. We've searched high and low and there's no place else. It has to go in Reading. And you're going to be asked, you might be asked to waive this requirement. But this provision is different from most other provisions that you have in that at the end of the day you can waive any of it. And the reason for that is because they always have the ability to go into federal court and get a judge to waive it for you. So just give you a chance to maybe hold on to it.
Yeah.
But so since you can waive it, it seems like it's a good idea to make your criteria exactly the way you want. And then they have to at least start off in the right direction.
I think, think we've come up with a pretty good draft.
Yeah. Yes.
I have one minor point. I was looking at the definitions, and will we use acronyms? It only shows up once, the special permit granting authority. We're including the acronym in parentheses after the definition. So if we're going to be using this PWSF, we might want to do the same thing with the definition.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Right.
It's like I say, it only comes up one other time, but.
Well, and just to be clear, this was drafted using SPGA because you hadn't told us yet what you wanted the SPGA to be.
Yeah.
But now that we clearly need CPDC,
just replace the.
Well, we'll want CPDC to appear here rather than SPGA.
Yeah.
Pretty much. In writing, everybody knows what the CPDC is.
Yeah, that's good. Take a quick opportunity. I saw a couple of what I thought might be typos. Bottom of page 4 and of page 5. This just didn't read right to me. Maybe I'm just not reading it correctly, but to concealment to the maximum extent practicable, PWSF shall conceal equipment, cables, and antennas within architectural surfaces that are ordinary and consistent with the context of the PWSF's the town of Reading environs, such as steeples. I don't know if it was adding the town of that made it confusing, but.
I don't think I made any changes to the template related to that.
That doesn't mean they couldn't have a typo.
Well, if you change the small s to a comma,
with the context of the PWSF, comma, the town of Reading environs.
Or.
Yeah, it's listed here in an older
draft. Why don't you just say in front of the.
Right.
Where?
With the context, consistent with the context of the PWSF, strike the S, in the town of Reading environs.
Mm. what you want to say is that there's ordinary and consistent with the environs of the town of Reading.
No.
Okay.
I think I would read it as being even smaller than that. It's the environs in the area of the PWSF, which may be different on one side of town than the other, or one context or the other. The interstate highway versus, up Route 28.
So within the context of the proposed site of the
PWSF? So you replace the small s with a within. Context of the PWSF within the town of Reading environments. Or,
yeah.
Location within, whatever.
Said because if it's in downtown, we don't want them to conceal it with a smokestack.
Right.
Yeah.
Although it's completely appropriate over by where there is already a smokestack.
Right. One general way.
Okay, that's good. And then I just saw a couple of acronyms that. People may not know what they are. I don't know what they are. But NEPA criteria, and then RF emissions. You want to spell those out?
Where do you see
that? Page nine
of the markup.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm looking at a version that I have at home. It may still be page 9 of the version that was in our desk packet. Yeah, it is.
It's still the red line version.
yeah, the red line version, note, letter X. Oh, actually, they're all letter X,
yeah,
sorry.
Yeah.
They're all letter X.
The last one before B.
Yeah.
Well, just replace RF with radio frequency.
Yep.
I mean, if you want.
What's NEPA?
National Environmental Policy
NEPA.
Act.
That's the, yeah.
Where is
RF? That's the federal
it's down a little bit.
Environmental impact statement.
It's towards the bottom.
Oh,
a little up. Up a little bit higher.
Above NEPA or below NEPA?
Oh, it should be below NEPA. Why am I not
seeing
it?
No, it's right above the B.
Oh, you know what?
Paragraph B.
No, now we're on to RF. Go down a little further. Maybe it is on the next page. There it is.
There you go. Radio
frequency. Yep. You can use small letters.
And we use FCC. Oh, you always write in that same place you were at. I don't know
there
if it was.
Noticing that the citation to the statute above there is not the form that we have used elsewhere. All that kind of, you know, polishing hasn't really happened.
Okay, well, that's fine.
No.
Yeah.
I just call my eyes.
So as long as, I mean.
I'm just going to highlight it.
Yeah.
So if we go back to the special permit requirements, the first thing, we have visual guidelines, and in this guide that Jesse put together, the question that she asks is, this also appears to cover many of the issues, well, this does appear, what's in our draft, to cover many of the issues with visual impacts. However, CPDC may want to require more requirements for lighting, no spillage, dark skies compliant. That's the first one. And then the second one, if this process is combined with site plan review, they would be required to submit all this information per the checklist for site plan review. And then there's something later on in the application procedure. So do we want to add something around lighting as far as visual impacts go?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's really only, it's security lighting. I mean, we can't, temporary maintenance, that's not really a site plan issue. So it's really security lighting, and that ends up falling into some different category.
Oh, okay.
But we can. I mean, we wouldn't do dark sky.
Well, they'd be lighting the buildings down below, the structures down below. They might have lights on a ladder, I guess. If it's the one on the smokestack, what kind of lighting would they have on it, other than, say, some FAA-type lighting on top?
Uh-huh.
Well, there's a comment on that in here already, right?
Potential scenarios, maybe what we have already is enough.
It's necessary at the discretion of the SPGA, so.
Oh, there is a comment like
yeah,
that?
Yeah, at the discretion of,
I mean, typically these things aren't in at all.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Except, you know, they may have some kind of security lighting so that if somebody has, you know, scaled the fence and they would have the ability to turn on some lights, but I'm not saying that they don't have lights, but just that lights are generally not
Right.
not on.
Okay.
The big lighting issue is if you have to mark it for the FAA.
Right.
You don't want that.
No.
Well,
so if there's something in here that says
right.
You know, it has to be lit for the FAA, then this is not a good spot. But this isn't like, you know, these things don't have people that work there.
Right.
And so it's not like the kinds of issues that you have, you know, with the parking lot or you expect it to be lit most of the time or all the time.
Okay. I think we're good there then.
Yeah. Basically, it's like item 6 on page 4 is the lighting.
Yeah.
Just notice this here. Is this not? This is not.
Yeah. It's
yeah.
Too.
That's, yeah. Sorry. I didn't see anything, or I couldn't think of anything else.
Okay.
When I read through this list.
As far as the visual guidelines.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I'm not saying there isn't, but it didn't come to my mind.
Right.
We've got some blanks that we want to fill in, which is the non-residential height and setback.
Oh yeah, yeah. Well, hold on, let's give me 1 second. Are we good on the visual requirements?
Nick,
was there anything
so.
Else that jumped out at you?
No.
Not there.
Okay. All right, let's talk about height then, because I guess as we may have some input on that.
I had a couple of comments before I saw this table. One was basically that the setback, if the structure is located in a non-residential district, but it's adjacent to a residential district, it borders it. Residential district immediately if the property, then the setback should be from the residential district. So we don't want to tell him he has to put it 100 feet back from the street line of the commercial district and push it all the way to the back of the lot right up against somebody's residential backyard.
My question is, knowing that this was a guide of what other towns have done, and that in most towns there are residential and non-residential districts that are of substantive size, where ours are our non-residential are pretty linear, where you can't get all that far away from a residential district. I wonder whether we even have the different designations. There's very few places in town where a tower would not be right up, like you say, right up against a residential district.
I wrote that too. I was like, does height matter? And what's the difference between 125 and 150 feet for that matter? But these regulations that are in here, North Andover is no more than 10 feet above the average height of buildings. This all flies? This will hold up?
Well, it's preferences, right?
To get to John's point, why waste our time? We could do this in the site plan review portion of it. They come in and they say, here's the lot, here's where we want to put it, and we look at it and say, well, keep it over here because it's away from the residents and it's not as obvious from our business B or something. And they'll tell us what height they want, and we'll have to negotiate that potentially. But in the end, they might just say, no, we need a 300-foot tower. And, you know, I don't know what we have to prohibit that. Or even if it's written down, can't be more than 20 feet. What does that really mean?
Well, what it means is that if you have your standards, they have to try to meet them, because they're going to have to demonstrate that when they come to you for a waiver, that the reason they need a waiver is not just we'd like a taller tower, but that we actually can't do what we need with a tower the size that satisfies you.
Mm.
With the setback, or you know, they, that they, by having a standard, and you're putting the burden on the company to come to you and demonstrate that they can't meet your standard. You just say, we'll all negotiate this in a site plan review. You're not putting any burden on them. They'll just come in and say, this is what we want. And you don't have anything to give, you don't have any standard to evaluate that against.
Okay.
To give them any pushback. And they don't have to prove to you that, that they say they want 175 feet, they don't have to prove to you that 150 feet won't do it.
So that's the point of it.
You can feel free to be as restrictive as you want, understanding that that this process is different from almost every other zoning process that you have,
mm-hmm.
which is it's all about which waivers are they going to be asking for. So I suppose it's something in like subdivision. Standard is higher because they have to actually demonstrate that they can't do it.
Okay.
The way you have.
Okay.
I like the north end over in Lincoln.
That would apply to regardless of district.
Okay.
I like the kind of putting it in the context of the surrounding environment.
Yeah, that's what I like about it. We know where they're going to put it, and we buy that lot first. That's what the CPA would be for.
Yeah. No, most towns that look at this as a revenue generating opportunity do write their zoning in such a way that it steers it steers the tower to. Municipally owned property. I don't know if that's where you want to go.
I don't want to bring it up because it's been mentioned in the past. I just don't see how it's a viable solution.
Yeah.
I don't see how we have that kind of
property.
Yeah, I just don't see where we have that.
That tower would look great right out in the parking lot here, wouldn't it?
Because you got nothing else.
When is our public hearing for this?
The 13th of July.
So that's our next meeting?
Yeah.
So this construct that you have here, or that you know, the non-residential and the residential, that's because that was an example, right?
Right.
No reason to follow that.
No,
or
just
not.
A lot of towns
have used that.
Have used that because their residential districts are, or I guess the non-residential districts are more.
Or where they,
right.
Where they aim to try and,
But as you say, your commercial districts are mostly linear. So, two blocks in from
from Main Street is a residential district, so probably doesn't make any, you know, much planning sense, but that's a planning judgment. You're free to make.
All right. In which case, I really I do like the North Andover one because it sets it in the context of the environment and less random, you know.
Yeah. One size fits all.
Yeah. Yeah.
So why don't we revise the draft to not break it out by district and follow the model of North Andover?
Yep. Just break it out by the, I guess it's this, the...
For the height?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about the setbacks?
So that it's would be, it's the co-location is the... Basically, on any exist co-location on an existing structure would be the first.
Well, the setback should just say it's going to follow the underlying district, and then if we want to add some additional pieces to that, we would. I think we talked about this last time, that if you start saying two times the height of the structure, that we don't know that we have lots that are even that deep.
Right.
Right. So.
Can't really do much.
Yeah, what does that number mean?
I don't know what two times means. I know what one time means, because people were concerned about, you know, thing falling over in a windstorm. If it's going to fall over a windstorm, it probably would be better if it didn't fall on the neighboring person's house.
Mm.
So maybe two times is intended so that
if it falls over and blows while it's going,
it's a little more. You know, one might not be quite enough. But I think that's primarily the safety reason.
Well, understanding
most of these setbacks, by the way, are from property lines as opposed to the street.
Right.
You know.
Well, understanding that even that, it would be unlikely for a tower company to come in and be able to meet that in Reading, if it was a taller tower, 200-foot tower. At least they'd have to, if they asked for the waiver, they'd have to go through the rationale of why they can't. And we could get into the safety discussion with the one times.
One times is fine. I get that rationale.
Yeah.
Fall zone. But so like they come back and they say we can't meet it because we just don't have enough room. There's no room. There isn't 150 feet from any place on the site to its property line.
But to remind, that all goes to whether they have. The answer might be that therefore you should be in a different site. It's, you know, this is a different kind of a process. It's not just you can't meet it here. It's also we can't meet it anywhere else that would address the
need
gap that we're trying to address.
Okay. Yeah, I really see them finding a way around any of these requirements. That's
absolutely, you're absolutely, and the whole idea of this bylaw is to make them prove it, and make them prove it to you instead of to some federal judge.
Right.
At least that's the first step. Yeah, some of them say one times plus 10 feet. I guess that's the extra.
That's when it blows.
For when it breaks.
And it bounces.
Well, then we should put something in there like 1, 1.5.
Oh.
We can waive anything, we can work with that thing.
Right.
I mean, or we could just keep it simple, basically say that the maximum height is 120 feet in all districts.
Because we don't know the size of the tower.
Right. Yeah, but the required setback, minimum setback would be, you know, 1x the tower plus something. Even if it's, you know, just the 30 feet, which is on top of the building, then the required setback would be like 40 feet. Because the building isn't going to fall over with it.
Well, you can certainly do it by tower, have a setback for towers and ground mounted, and then you can have a separate setback.
Right, this is how this is worded.
Yeah,
for
building.
Two times structure for ground mounted, and then pre-existing structures, provisions of the underlying district.
Right. Okay.
So what did we agree to? 1, 1.5, or 1+?
Let's do 1.5.
Okay.
Right. Or for ground mounted.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And then for building mounted underlying district.
Yeah.
Yep.
Do we need that minimum? Probably not, right?
No.
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 Okay. Okay, good. So does that address height and setbacks? I think it does. Oh, then there's another question, or the draft bylaw requires additional setback of a factor of 3 to existing dwellings, schools, childcare facilities, nursing or convalescent home, or assisted living facility. So do we want to increase that requirement for those types?
Or
sure.
Don't
this
think.
That is there in the model, so you can think about whether you want to do it. Our experience is that whenever you propose cell tower siting or cell tower bylaws or regulations, the vast majority of the comments you receive has to do public health impact of these facilities, something that we are prohibited from regulating directly. So that kind of a provision is there so that you, the way of addressing that concern without addressing
really
that concern explicitly. So.
Very clever.
I like it. I would put it in then.
Okay.
Well,
the
scientist of me says that we shouldn't bother, but.
But it's there in the model so that you can think about whether you want to
town meeting
to address
mm-hmm.
that. You put something in there to help those who are primarily focused on the public health impacts.
And we have people in town that are very concerned.
I'm sure they are. I mean,
I think
it's not, no, look at it, it's not that it's not a legitimate thing to be concerned.
Of course, yeah, I understand.
It's just, it is or it isn't based on the science, but the law says you can't.
Yeah.
It's, the companies obviously have very effective lobbyists.
Let's add it.
Maybe add it. So at a public hearing, an applicant comes in and they're making a proposal. You know we're going to have a room full of people who are here to discuss those points.
Uh-huh.
Does the chair have to continuously say we can't discuss that?
Well, it's not that you can't discuss it. You just can't. You can't address it in your decision.
Okay. But it lets people voice their concerns.
Right.
Well, within kind of depends on you know how to control the meeting.
Well, I mean, we kind of saw it a little bit with, it's a good question, with what is it, the school that's moving into Summer Ave.
Uh-huh.
And we were like, no, we're not gonna discuss whether or not this is Dover Amendment. That decision's kind of been made, and somebody brought up a great point, like, this is a public hearing, we should be able to talk about it.
No, and I think it's fine. I think the chair would state that, you know, the federal regulations don't allow us to consider that in citing this thing. And that's fine, as long as they know, so that they don't think that we're not addressing their concerns, or that we don't care about their concerns. It's
right.
Just that there's no process for dealing with it.
Right. Yeah.
So you put those kinds of setbacks in, and it sort of addresses that concerns.
And that's how we sell it to town meeting.
Okay. The concern, however, I mean, is basically your thing about the geography of the town. It says 3 times the height of the antenna to an existing dwelling. You know, 3 times the height of the antenna to an existing dwelling is like every square foot of the town.
Yeah, I don't know if we include dwelling.
I thought we took care of the residential districts. I would focus on the special
school, child care facility, nursing, convalescent home, and assisted living
facility. Okay. About the actual number?
Yeah, 3 times the height is a reasonable place to start the negotiation.
It's good as any.
Yeah.
40 times the height.
40.
Yeah, just a number.
Just a number.
Okay. Good. So I think we're good on that. And then the last part was the preliminary application phase, and if we're going to streamline the application process with site plan review. And I think, Jesse, staff has an opinion on this, right? If I remember reading this correctly.
For the application procedures?
Consider revising this section to not reference rules and regulations or have the CPDC establish those such rules and regulations. Where is it?
Yeah.
I say, yeah, this should definitely fall within site plan review, right?
And we charge a fee for this? To review this application?
It falls under site plan review, of course.
Yes. Yes, you absolutely can. And first of all, because it's a special permit. So yes, by statute. And under our bylaw, you also can do it for site plan review.
So does the site plan review process as it exists right now, and would there be any gaps at all in using that process to facilitate these PWSFs coming into this town? I mean, can that be our solution here, or do we have to come up with more?
Need to, as the way I sort of breeze through this and understand it, so they would come in and they'd need to do 2 things. They'd have to go through to get a special permit and go through site plan.
You can hold those hearings.
What's that?
Yeah.
And you can hold those hearings together.
Yeah, we've done that
you
before.
You could, yeah.
So
but addressing 2 sort of different but related issues.
Mm-hmm.
One which there's a different level of control over than the other.
Right.
We don't actually have a special permit application form for CPDC special permits.
And shouldn't that be on the list?
Well, if you don't have one, we should require that they submit one.
we do have site plan, we do have a site plan review.
That's all right.
Application.
But whether they're, what, forget about this particular issue that we're talking about now. What if someone comes in for a special permit for something else?
We, like the one that we just did for the home occupation, we had her request one under the appropriate section and sort of the letterhead. That's sort of the way we address it that way without having an actual form. And she, I don't know if you remember that application, she outlined all the criteria and how she met it.
Okay. I'm not waiting to forms.
Yeah. And you say to work with staff, so.
Yeah.
I mean, we certainly can create a form that's not an issue.
Just this?
Oh,
no.
I'm not advocating for a form,
yeah.
Just to make sure that there's a there's a process.
Yeah, I guess I'm just trying to understand where we are. Are we covered? Have we answered everything? Yet?
Well, you asked the question, what happens after this preliminary application?
Yeah.
And I think what was intended was then after that it's just treated the same way you treat any other special permit application, supposed to be the same, the usual process. But so this was intended not to be to set out a whole procedure, but just the extra pieces that might be special to the section. So special things are encouraging them to do a preliminary application.
Let's see.
Okay. Making sure it's clear that this doesn't take the place of site plan review, but it means site plan review. And isn't there something else?
But yeah, we have the preliminary application phase, and then we have site plan review, and then
consultant review.
Yeah. I'm wondering
then
if
what?
Consultant
what?
Review.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Which they pay for.
Which they pay for. Yeah.
And what's included in the preliminary application again?
The applicant is encouraged to meet with our office to initiate the dialogue, and then
okay.
The SPVA rules and. This does reference these rules and regulations,
which we're not going to have.
I'm wondering if this is almost like our DRT.
It sounds like it.
Mm-hmm.
A development.
DRT. Not a DRT.
The DRT.
Not just any DRT.
Yeah. The DRT.
Design review team.
Development review.
Development review team. Okay.
Is that formalized in any of our bylaws or?
It's in
well,
our site plan rules and regulations.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
But not in the actual bylaw.
Yeah, that, you know, it seems like we don't have to have a whole new set of procedures and stuff. Like
right,
this.
No, we shouldn't. Yeah.
Especially since it seems unlikely that you're going to get any applications. Or
yeah,
whatever. So.
This is really, I mean,
well,
what we do at the DRT, we clarify a lot of the zoning. We try and anticipate CBDC's concerns. We can certainly scratch this and, you know, sort of revise it to speak to the development review team specifically.
Mm-hmm. Let's do that.
Well, that's, I mean, basically we've got Section 5.6 in the existing bylaw is uses by special permit. And what we're replacing is 5.6.3, which is the commercial communication structures. And it's basically, I mean, what's there now is just over a page. And we'll be replacing it with the new thing. But each one starts off with, site plan or site development things or application requirements, criteria for approval, et cetera.
Right.
So it fits into the structure, right?
So in essence, we should just be referencing back to that
the structure that already
exists.
What was it?
Right, is that what you're?
Right.
Yeah.
That's a good point, that's good.
So, I'm sorry, Dave, which?
563, for example, starts off, special permit for PWSF, et cetera, whether itself a principal use or as an accessory use, shall be constructed, you know, nothing without a special permit, blah, blah, blah. And this is where, currently it says the ZBA, but we would change that. And then the, like the next to the last paragraph on the next page, says special permit, you know, shall remain valid only so long as the owner of such structure, et cetera, et cetera. And so there's a couple of very good provisions in the existing one.
Right.
Okay.
And we'll just.
Copy as we want to do.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'll sort of take another stab at this then.
You know, wrap it around, or wrap it in the existing.
Yeah.
Stuff.
So it feels like, all right, Jesse's gonna take a shot at filling all this in, then it's gotta go back to us for us to scrub.
Yep.
So now, does that give enough time?
Well, if you're seriously thinking of having a hearing on this bylaw in 2 weeks from today.
Already advertised.
Already advertised it. So you've advertised what?
The hearing.
Oh, what is the specifics?
What do you have on file for?
For this.
This with all the X's and stuff, okay.
Yeah.
All right, you can do that.
Yeah.
When do you think we can get a updated version to review?
I could certainly get ready something by the end of this week. I don't know what your office is looking like next week with the holiday coming up.
Well, it's crisp, it's gonna be here, not me, because I've got something else. Oh, I know, I have something else here, I have fire.
They're gonna say like vacation or something.
No, no, nothing as good as that, no. Firearm committee, you know, that's its own special.
If I were able to get it to Chris by the end of this week, that would give him next week.
Yeah.
To look at it, I would just need it back by the 9th to include in our packets.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think that's fine.
I mean, worse.
I'm mostly committing Chris's time, so it's, you know, it's really easy. Oh, yeah, I'm sure he can do it.
Chris, he's good.
He's the.
Yeah, he's confident.
If he tells me that we, that this is not possible, I will alert you right away. I think it should be fine.
Okay.
She's got one on the case at the end of July. Last 2 weeks or something.
Okay.
Good, so you've got everything, we've got everything we need.
I believe we do.
That's good, I feel like we've been dragging this one a little bit. Finally got this. Anything else we need to discuss tonight? For the good of the order?
Did anybody have any other comments?
Yeah, anybody? Public, any other comments?
We told a public hearing.
Thank you.
All right, I think we're good.
Move to adjourn.
Second, all those in favor?
Wait.